हाय,
हेलो
हाय
सर। हाय
स्नेहा, स्कॉलिंग अंदर। अब ज्वाइन, अब ज्वाइन।
What happened to
I talked to them.
You pulled a Karan.
Who's pulled a Karan?
Good work. Are you going to take over? Or will it be Sneha? Sir, I'll just begin
sure.
The liquidation process. So, as I have mentioned earlier, the focus of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code is on revival. So, a liquidation order is passed in a very, very limited circumstance, which I have reproduced on the screen here. The first case is in the event there is no resolution plan that is submitted during the 180-day plus 90-day moratorium period, or in the event if such a resolution plan is submitted that it doesn't comply with the requirements set out in the code. Sneha had covered these requirements yesterday, but briefly, just to recap, a few of these requirements are that the resolution plan has to provide for...
Shilpa, just a second. I think it'll be better if you could just start off by distinguishing resolution from liquidation before we move on to the procedure adopted or when liquidation is initiated. If you could just very briefly, you know, set out the difference between resolution and liquidation.
So resolution entails that the business of the company will continue as a going concern. Once a resolution process is over, the debts of the company are restructured and the company begins its business again as a going concern, which is not necessary in the case of liquidation. Liquidation more often than not entails in dissolution of the company as a whole and puts a stop on its business. This is only resorted to if the belief is that the assets of the company or the organizational capital of the company is just not enough for the company to continue to survive anymore, and it's best if the assets are sold off and whatever minimum value can be paid to the creditors is paid off and the business is just put to rest.
No, so in a nutshell, basically resolution is where the company itself continues, albeit with a different management, definitely with a different shareholder altogether. Whereas in a liquidation, the company itself is brought to an end. The business may get transferred altogether if it's a if the business is, if the liquidation is carried out in such a manner where all the assets are sold off together, But the in a nutshell, the difference is that in a resolution, the idea is to resolve the debts of the company. The company goes on, the company being a distinct and a separate legal entity. Whereas in a liquidation, the company itself comes to an end. Is that what you're saying, Shilpa?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So, yeah, let's get back there.
So, like Deepak sir said, because the focus of resolution is to resolve the debts of the company, in the event there is no way to resolve the debts of the company, that's when a liquidation order can be passed. This situation arises if there is no resolution plan submitted or if a resolution plan does not comply with the requirements that are set out in the code. A few of these requirements are that the resolution plan must necessarily give that much amount of an operational creditor and dissenting financial creditor's debt as they would have ordinarily got upon liquidation. Whatever the liquidation value of their claim is should be given to them under this resolution plan at the minimum. And a resolution plan should ideally set out a mode of implementation and supervision of the entire resolution process, implementation of the resolution plan and a supervision process for that. There are more requirements, but broadly, if these requirements are not met, then the adjudicating authority will reject that resolution plan and move to liquidation of the corporate debtor. A liquidation can also be resorted to if once the committee of creditors is formulated, they are of the opinion that there is no resolution that is possible of the debts of the company. And 66% of the committee of creditors in majority passes a resolution stating their consent to move to liquidation of the corporate debtors' assets as opposed to attempting to resolve the debts of the company. In that case, the liquidator will then apply to the NCLT and seek a liquidation order. And finally, liquidation order can also be passed if once a resolution plan is approved, there is contravention of this resolution plan to the prejudice of any party. So if an operational creditor or a dissenting financial creditor is promised certain sums under a resolution plan, and once the resolution plan is implemented, they are not given this amount, or they are not given this amount in probably the timeline or the manner in which it was set out in the resolution plan, and this prejudices them, they can apply to the NCLT, satisfy the NCLT of the contravention and the prejudice caused to them, and seek a liquidation order of the corporate debtor in that case.
Shilpa, could you just tell us the practical implications of this, of this provision? You just said that the scenario that you gave is if an operational creditor is not given what he was promised in a resolution plan, he's entitled to move the NCLT for seeking a liquidation of the company on the basis that the resolution plan itself was contravened. But practically speaking, would this be a wise choice to exercise?
No, because usually a single operational creditor's debt in an entire resolution plan would be minuscule. And if otherwise it's not actually causing any difference, I don't think the...
But is it just the quantum of the operational creditor's claim which is to guide or lead the NCLT to allow or not allow? Or are there any other circumstances that the operational creditor should bear in mind and keep in mind?
It's necessary to satisfy the NCLT as to what is the prejudice that you're claiming is being caused to you. It's not just necessary that you show that there is a contravention. You have to convince that the prejudice caused is sufficient to justify the passing of a liquidation order. So which is why probably this just the mere fact that your quantum of your debt is not coming to you, or that it's not coming to you in the amount of time you promised, may not be enough. But it could result in the...
A bare reading of the provision does not provide for that. I mean, it does not provide for any discretion on the NCLT to look into whether the prejudice caused is adequate enough or not, does it?
No, it doesn't say adequate, but it definitely says that you have to there are two parts to this liquidation order. You, in your application,
to my understanding, simply stating and establishing that there is some prejudice that has been caused should be enough for the NCLT to pass an order.
So because I mean, I've attempted to look at whether there's any judicial pronouncement which interprets this provision. I have not come across it yet. But
there are very few. There are very few. So I mean, before you know, she proceeds. There are very few judicial pronouncements that are there on liquidation as on date. I mean, not too many cases that have gone into liquidation as such, apart from cases where there is voluntary liquidation. That's where the company's promoters and the company's board itself has applied for. So I agree, there are very few judgments. Anyways, go on. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so but the, just section, because it uses the term and between the two phrases, which is an application has to be made by a person other than the corporate debtor who is prejudiced by the contravention of the resolution plan, seems to indicate that it may not have to be the adequacy of the prejudice caused, but you definitely have to prove that there is a prejudice caused and it results from the contravention of the plan. And just the fact that I got paid a little late or probably less than the sum I was promised, but still in it is more than the sum that I would have gotten on liquidation, I don't think would entail passing of a liquidation order.
Also, just to add on, to my mind, this, I mean, though the provision's been incorporated and been put into the code, to my mind, for an operational creditor specifically to reach out to the NCLT for an liquidation may not be the wisest thing to do, because more often than not, an operational creditor who may be getting something but under the resolution plan is likely to get nothing when it comes to liquidation of the corporate debtor, because very rarely do you have, I mean, of course, there may be a situation where the assets of the company may exceed the liabilities of a corporate debtor. But having said that, there'll be very, very rare instances where the assets of a company would exceed the liability of the corporate debtor. So it's basically, insofar as an operational creditor is concerned, or maybe, you know, once you, have we discussed the distribution waterfall before? Have you guys discussed the distribution waterfall before?
No, sir, we haven't. I can go that first.
So let's not jump the gun. We'll come to the distribution waterfall, but essentially just telling everyone, distribution waterfall is essentially how the code says the assets of a company are to be distributed in the event of a liquidation. Having said that, this also applies to resolution proceedings. In fact, the resolution plan, when it's accepted by the COC as well as the IRP and eventually the NCLT, any payment plan proposed by a resolution applicant would also have to keep the provision and the order of payments as stipulated under the distribution waterfall, which is section 53 of the code.
Actually, so the recent amendment has done away with that requirement. Earlier, the NCLT and NCLAT's pronouncements were to this effect, that section 53, or which is a liquidation waterfall, is a guiding principle for resolution applicants as well. But recently, it has been stated that a resolution plan need not follow the priority in payments as set out.
Is this the latest amendment? I'm so sorry, but I think I completely agree with it, because there, you know, so there was this judgment by the NCLAT earlier where Justice Mukhopadhyay had held that there has to be some difference between a resolution plan. He had said it in the context where the resolution applicant had proposed a plan where the operational creditors were getting nothing. And the operational creditors had moved the NCLAT saying that they cannot be stripped of their claims altogether. Justice Mukhopadhyay, I forget the judgment, but Justice
Mukhopadhyay... It's a seamless private limited. United Seamless Tableau Private Limited.
So Justice Mukhopadhyay went on to hold that there is some difference between a resolution plan, a resolution proceedings and liquidation proceedings, and hence you cannot altogether do away with the claims of the operational creditor.
Yes.
This was, I believe, set aside. This judgment was set aside by the Supreme Court, but this amendment brings in a little more reason.
Yes. So the amendment actually states the amendment states that it's not necessary for a resolution plan to follow the priority in payments in that set out for liquidation. And secondly, there is an amendment which has also been made to the CIRP regulation, which in fact states that an operational creditor's debts will take priority over a financial creditor's debt in the resolution plan, in the payment, sorry, of the plan.
Right.
So
let's get back.
Yes, I'll just move on to the consequences of a liquidation order similar to an order passed under an application under Section 7 or Section 9. A liquidation order necessarily entails a public announcement by the liquidator of the liquidation process to all the creditors of the corporate debtor. A liquidation order results in an immediate discharge of all the employees or workmen of the corporate debtor. There is an exception set out under the code if the liquidator feels that it is necessary for the business of the corporate debtor to continue during the period of liquidation, then in that event, only those employees who are essential for continuance of this business will be retained during the period of liquidation. And lastly, there is a moratorium on any suit or proceeding being initiated by or against the corporate debtor during the period of liquidation. The liquidator has been given specific powers to initiate any suit or proceeding on behalf of the corporate debtor in very specific circumstances to enforce the right of a corporate debtor, but not otherwise.
No, and for that, he has to take the leave and permission of the adjudicating authority before he does so.
Yes.
No, but before we move on to that, who is a liquidator?
I'm just moving on to that. So, a liquidator, a resolution professional under the CIRP process will be appointed as a liquidator by the NCLT on passing of the liquidation order. Unless he does not submit, this is subject to his submitting a written consent to act as a liquidator of the corporate debtor. If he fails to submit this written consent, then he will not be appointed as a resolution professional, or he will be replaced, he will not be appointed as a liquidator, he will be replaced as the liquidator of the corporate debtor if he is so appointed.
There is a very detailed procedure also insofar as how the replacement process is to be gone about. Let's not get into that because I think that's very technical and not required for this discussion.
Yes. There are other things that do disqualify a resolution professional, but like Deepak says, we won't go into that. More often than not, the resolution professional who is in charge of the CIRP is automatically appointed as the liquidator of the corporate debtor. After appointment of the liquidator, he is supposed to make a public announcement of the liquidation proceedings. The public announcement has to necessarily specify the last date for submission of claims by creditors. As per the regulations, this is 30 days after the passing of the liquidation order. The public announcement also has to specify address and details of the liquidator for making of such claims. So do you want to add anything?
No, please go ahead.
So the next step is appointment of valuers. Initially, the liquidation regulations necessitated appointment of two registered valuers for valuing the assets of the corporate debtor for the purposes of liquidation. However, now the legislature has realized that usually there is a CIRP process preceding a liquidation process, which already entails valuation of the assets of a liquidator in the manner as set out in Section 53. So they have given the discretion to the liquidator to use that valuation as the basis for his valuation for the purposes of liquidation, or if he believes that the earlier valuation was not satisfactory, then he can proceed to appoint two registered valuers to make...
Not satisfactory, or you know, there may be circumstances which entails a difference or let's say a reduced or an enhanced liquidation value of the assets of the company. I mean, it could be either.
Yes.
Because usually it's going to be the same... the same resolution professional who's also appointed as a liquidator. So for him to say that the previous liquidation value was the liquidation value report taken wasn't satisfactory would be a little would be a little absurd because he's the one who had the liquidation value obtained earlier itself. But there could also be, I mean, apart from that, let's say there's a change in the liquidator and the liquidator is someone who was not the resolution professional, then he could perhaps say that the previous valuation reports were not satisfactory, or there could be also a change in circumstances which would lead to a different liquidation value altogether.
Yes.
Go on.
So this the registered valuers that are appointed have to, there is a timeline set out for them to submit the valuation report, which is 75 days from the date of the appointment, from the date of passing of the liquidation order, which is also referred to as a liquidation commencement date. There is also a requirement which is newly inserted by the 2019 amendment, which in the liquidation regulations, which states that all the stakeholders which are identified by a liquidator, premature, I'll move on to the next point and then explain this. The next stage is verification and acceptance of claims. There is, unlike in the process of CIRP, there is no discretion on a liquidator to accept claims any time beyond 30 days from the liquidation commencement date. So all claims have to be submitted to the liquidator within 30 days in the form and manner that is provided in the liquidation regulations. Once he receives the claim, the liquidator is in charge with verifying the claims and either accepting or rejecting them. The creditors whose claims have been rejected or have been accepted in part and not entirely can file an appeal before NCLT within 14 days of the acceptance or rejection. The acceptance or rejection has to happen within 7 days from the expiry of the 30-day period for making of your claim. The interesting part is that the liquidator has to then compile a list of stakeholders, including details regarding the amounts that are admitted, the extent to which these debts are secured or unsecured, and submit this list within 45 days from the receipt of claims to the adjudicating authority. At all times, this list is available for inspection by any stakeholder or by any interested party. So that could be a guarantor of the corporate debtor, a partner of the corporate debtor. They can inspect this at any time, either in the records of the adjudicating authority or on the website of the corporate debtor, if that is possible. And all of these stakeholders who form a part of the list of stakeholders have to then form a committee which consults with and advises the liquidator at each stage during the liquidation process. This requirement of a stakeholders consultation committee has come in through the 2019 amendment only. So do you want to add anything?
Not now. Go on.
The next step will be formation of a liquidation estate. A liquidation estate is basically just a compilation of all the assets of a company. There are two ways to sort of do this. One second, I'll just move on to. Yes, so there are two things, two guiding principles set out in the code as to what can be included in the liquidation estate and what has to be excluded from it. Obviously, assets over which a corporate debtor does not have possession, which belong to a third party, cannot be included in the liquidation estate. But what is interesting is if you see the fourth entry in inclusions, assets in respect of which security interest has been relinquished by a secured creditor. So the interesting bit is that the insolvency and bankruptcy code recognizes that a secured creditor has a certain right to property in a secured interest which they've gotten under a lawful enactment such as SAFESI or something. So it gives them the right to realize their security interest, recover whatever amount is owed to them from that security itself. If there's an excess, then report that to the liquidator. And
can we deal with this later once we go to the distribution waterfall, Shilpa?
All right, sir.
I think
this is a part of waterfall.
No, so basically what a secured creditor has two positions in the waterfall. I mean, there are certain monies which are due to in terms of the distribution waterfall to a secured creditor who has relinquished his security interest, and
that's right.
Separately to a secured creditor who has not relinquished his security interest. So we'll deal with that, I think, once we get to the waterfall.
Otherwise, there are clear indications in the code as to what is to be included in a liquidation estate and what is to be excluded from it. I just wanted actually in this focus more on the relinquishment of security interest for secured creditor. Otherwise, assets which are subject to determination by authority probably fall. The corporate debtor will be entitled to subject to such determination, will be included in the liquidation estate, but personal assets of any shareholder or partner will not be.
Is there a timeline for the liquidation process, Shilpa?
Earlier when the code was enacted, there was a 2-year timeline set out for the entire liquidation process. However, it's recently been amended to 1 year.
But then what about a situation where there is some litigation going on by virtue of which the corporate debtor may gain control and ownership or interest in a particular property? Now that litigation may not get over within that 1-year period. What about a situation where the litigation itself does not come to an end?
So a liquidator has been given the right to seek an extension of time from the adjudicating authority listing out the reason. So this would be a very valid reason to seek an extension of the liquidation process. But the other
litigation could indefinitely go on. There are also several layers of appeals that parties may have. Would a liquidator be entitled to seek a deferral or seek an extension of time for the liquidation?
It doesn't seem so, because
in a situation like this, maybe that asset will have to be left out altogether.
Yes.
But leaving that asset out altogether then renders that litigation itself infructuous. Because if the liquidation goes on, without this particular asset concerned, then, you know, assuming that the liquidation goes on, the company is dissolved, the company is liquidated, and let's say that the corporate debtor does win that litigation 5 years down the line, who does the property vest in? There are too many ifs and buts over here.
I think if there was to be like a practical application and where this situation is actually raised, then as the legislature has done in all cases with the insolvency and bankruptcy code, they'll probably act to amend this or clarify it in some manner. Because as of this instance, nothing like this has arisen, and the code or the regulation don't envisage a situation where assets of a corporate debtor could actually be tied up in a liquidation and hence not be able to be realized. But otherwise, there is a maximum timeline of 1 year. Earlier it was 2 years, but this timeline is extendable subject to the satisfaction of the NCLT.
Extendable by?
There is no maximum period.
No maximum period. Right.
So the next step is preparation of an asset memorandum and other reports. Asset memorandum is very similar to the information memorandum under the CIRP process. It will contain a value of the assets as per the valuation report. It probably the intended manner of their sale, which I'll get to when I talk about sale of assets. The expected amount that each asset is expected to bring in, and any other relevant information about the sale of assets. For instance, whether the sale of assets will be carried out by auction or private sale, any such information will be contained in the asset memorandum. This asset memorandum has to be filed with the NCLT within 75 days of the passing of the liquidation order.
Right.
The liquidator is also mandated to file several reports at each stage of the liquidation process, just so that the NCLT can supervise that the process is going at the pace that it's supposed to go and that there is no unnecessary delays. So the first report will be the preliminary report. Again, it is supposed to be filed within 75 days of the liquidation commencement date. The preliminary report has to give the capital structure, the estimates of the assets and liabilities, estimated liquidation cost, and details like that. If after preparation of this preliminary report, it appears to a liquidator that there is not enough assets or liabilities in the owned by the corporate debtor, or as Deepak sir had mentioned, in the event that most of the assets of the corporate debtor are caught up in liquidation and not likely to be realized, he can apply for an early dissolution of the corporate debtor at this stage, just so that there are no unnecessary liquidation costs that are incurred in order to attempt to sell assets which the corporate debtor does not possess at the moment or cannot effectively realize.
No, but there is a problem in this. The problem is, again, something we'll deal with, or maybe if you could just remind us of discussing this when we come to the distribution waterfall, because the promoters of the company are also entitled to proceeds from the liquidation. Once, yes. You know, they albeit are they're there at the bottom of the list. Hmm. But if there is anything that remains, that goes to the promoters of the company. Now, a promoter of the company could stall the liquidation process by simply saying that there are other assets which are caught up in litigation, and they need not necessarily be immovable assets. They can also be movable assets. They could be actionable claims, ongoing actionable claims where they are to receive claims. And a promoter could always argue that, the claims, if allowed by an arbitration or let's say a civil court, would be more than adequate to not only address all debts of the company, but also for monies which the promoters may receive upon liquidation. So a situation like this could actually derail the liquidation process altogether. I do not know to what extent the courts would accept this argument of a liquidator, the NCLT, NCLAT, or the Supreme Court. But theoretically speaking, that possibility is distinct.
Definitely. It's just, I think they're trying to cut down the liquidation process as much as possible. So they've given this discretion to the liquidator, but in practically speaking, how effective it could be is obviously up for debate. There are also progress reports that are to be filed on a quarterly basis by the liquidator during the liquidation process. Typically will entail informing the NCLT of any change in situation. So if earlier he had mentioned a certain realizable value for an asset and that now has either increased or decreased according to his estimations, he has to include it in his progress reports. Details of any material litigation going on against the corporate debtor will also be indicated in these progress reports. There are also, these progress reports will also be accompanied with sale reports as and when he manages to sell assets, annual status reports, reports of the consultation with stakeholders. As I had mentioned, the compulsory committee of stakeholders has to be formed, and any minutes of those meetings have to be filed with the NCLT. And ultimately, the final report just prior to dissolution has to be filed with the NCLT.
Right.
Next step is the sale of assets. So before moving to sale of assets, do you want to talk about avoidable transactions?
Sorry, can you say that again?
So should we discuss avoidable transactions before moving to sale of assets?
No, let's move on with sale of assets. I'll get on to, so there are certain transactions which can be recognized by a liquidator. Just to sum it up, we'll move on to this later once the entire process has been gone through. But there are certain transactions which can be identified by a liquidator, in fact, identified by the COC, who could then report it to the liquidator. The liquidator then applies to the NCLT for having these transactions altogether set aside. These are preferential transactions. They are extortionate credit transactions. There are also transactions which are being carried out by the corporate debtor to defraud creditors. So we'll get on with what amounts to an undervalued transaction or a preferential transaction or a transaction defrauding creditor or an extortionate credit transaction, and what is the process to have them set aside once we are done with the entire process.
All right, sir. Sale of assets, there are a couple of there are actually six specific ways set out under the liquidation regulations for carrying out sale of assets. The liquidator can carry out a sale of assets on a standalone basis or in a slump sale manner. As a result of
Would this be a slump sale as per the IT Act, or would this be a slump sale, a separate slump sale altogether? Guys, just give me a minute. I'll get back onto the call. Just give me a minute, please.
So just to answer Deepak's question, I think it will be a slump sale as per the IT Act.
But the definition of slump sale is derived from the IT Act, but even a Companies Act provides for slump sale of assets. So basically, people go for slump sale mainly because of the tax implications.
So that's there, but then I thought that there are certain employees who will be removed. Once the employees are removed, a transaction meet the requirements of a slump sale under the IT Act.
No, so I think it will be two different things. So if assets are sold in a slump sale, that I think is envisaged in a manner under the IT Act, but assets and liabilities and employees all sort of moving.
It's a transfer of all assets and it includes a slump sale under the IT Act. Please correct me if I'm wrong, but to my understanding, a slump sale under the IT Act also entails transfer of all employees of the company on an as-is-whereas basis. You cannot refuse to take on certain employees.
That's right. Slump sale. That's right.
So, I mean, the definition under the regulations is derived from the IT Act. So, to that extent, I think it is envisaged in that manner. But right now, I mean, the provision specifically talks only about sale of assets. So, I don't know if in that sense it involves the transfer of employees as well. That could possibly be covered under the newly inserted modes of sale of assets, which are sale of the corporate debtor as a going concern, or the business of the corporate debtor as a going concern, which have been inserted after the decisions of NCLT, Kolkata and Gujarat, NRE, Coke. Sneha, would you like to add something?
Not at the moment.
Okay. So NCLT, Kolkata went ahead to sell the entire business of the corporate debtor as a going concern in the case of Gujarat, NRE, Coke, again, in the interest of the business, whatever the value that is retained in the business, continuing to survive to whatever extent possible. As a result of that, that method, even though earlier did not exist under the code or its regulations, has been inserted by the 2019 amendment to the liquidation regulation.
That's also not just in the interest of the business going on, but also in the interest of the creditors of the corporate debtor, because the value of an asset or value of the assets of the company, if they are sold by way of a strip sale, which is basically one asset a piece at a time, The value could be way lesser than what the value of the assets would in together form. The value of the assets could be way more if they're sold as a whole lot going together. It's basically transfer of a business.
Yes. So the sale of assets, as I had mentioned earlier, can happen by way of auction. Actually, it necessarily has to happen by way of auction unless special permission has been taken to conduct private sale of the assets from the NCLT. The permission is granted in cases where the asset is either a perishable asset or it is capable of deterioration in value if it is not sold immediately, and the process of government auction usually takes time. The permission to sell the asset by private sale can also be taken if the asset is sold at a higher price than the reserve price of a failed auction. This is very technical, so I'm not going to get into it. But in all of these cases, there has to be prior permission of the adjudicating authority to conduct a private sale. So I'll move on to the distribution of assets as per the waterfall, liquidation waterfall, just a moment. So section 53 of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code sets out a order in which payments must be made under a liquidation plan to the creditors and stakeholders of the corporate debtor. I've reproduced it on the slide. I'll just quickly run through it. The first and foremost thing that has to be taken care of and paid is insolvency resolution process costs and the liquidation costs. Liquidation costs will include the costs for auction and sale of assets, etc. The second point is whether we wanted to
including the liquidator's fee.
So the liquidator's fee is included in liquidation costs, but I wanted to discuss that a little later because it's very interesting. What there is a new amendment to the code and there's something that has been set out, so we'll just get back to it a little later. But do you want to discuss the relinquishment of security creditors' interest over here?
Yeah, once you've just quickly run through the waterfall.
All right.
Okay. So the order. Let's just quickly run through the order and then we'll quickly get on to relinquishment of a secured creditor.
A workman's dues and dues that are owed to a secured creditor who has relinquished his security interest are ranked in equal priority and they will be paid right after payment of the IRP costs and liquidation costs. Thereafter, any dues payable to employees or workmen for a 12-month period prior to liquidation. So usually this is the period during which possibly the insolvency resolution process was going on. Thereafter, unsecured creditors are next in line. Then the interesting part about the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code as opposed to the procedure envisaged on the Companies Code is that the government's dues actually rank far lower in the waterfall than they did under the Companies Act. Interests of unsecured creditors, as well as creditors who've relinquished their security interests, employees, everyone is taken care of before government's dues are paid, which is different from what was envisaged in the Companies Act. Finally, debts owed to any secured creditor after enforcement of their security interest, any remaining debts and dues, and then finally, whatever would be payable to promoters or partners of the corporate debtor, being preference shareholders or equity shareholders, will be the last rung of the liquidation waterfall. Earlier, there was an understanding that any subordination agreements, they're called, between creditors will not be allowed, which are in contravention of the liquidation waterfall, but the legislature has gone on to clarify that if these agreements are between creditors of equal ranking, such as, you know, creditors, workmen and a secure creditor who's relinquished his security interest, then these possibly would not be in contravention of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, or between a secured creditor who has relinquished a security interest and another similarly placed secured creditor will not be in contravention of the code. So the code provides for a formula for deduction of the liquidator's fees. Each of the recipients' portions. However, what they have done is that they've linked the formula to the amount of time taken for the process of liquidation. The longer that the liquidator takes to complete the liquidation process, the lesser his fees will be in order to encourage him to complete the entire process quickly. But this could be counterproductive because there could be delays beyond his control and he spends more time and gets paid less, which is a disincentive in my opinion.
So also we don't want any liquidator to rush through the liquidation proceedings and which may result in a lower liquidation value of the assets of the company.
Definitely.
So should we move on to the security interest?
Yes, sir.
So if you look at Section 53, which provides the distribution waterfall, there are two classes of secured creditors, and they rank differently in the distribution waterfall. A secured creditor who has relinquished his security interest is higher in the distribution waterfall, and a secured creditor who realizes his security interest before the assets are computed for the liquidation asset value of the corporate debtor is ranked lower in the distribution waterfall. what this basically means is a secured creditor, or secured creditor one is a creditor whose exposure is secured by way of a security interest. It could be anything. It could be a movable, it could be an immovable asset. And the idea behind the court is that, so one, the court recognizes that a security interest is of pretty much, I mean, barring workman's dues and barring IRP, insolvency resolution costs and liquidation costs, a secured creditor's security interest is given paramount importance. Now, the court also says that a secured creditor could either realize a security interest. Section 52 lays down as to how he can do it and what he needs to do. Or he could relinquish his security interest so that the asset which was secured against his exposure is contributed to the liquidation asset value and everyone gets a portion of it. So that is the understanding, I mean, the intention behind the court. The court says that any secured creditor who has relinquished his security interest will be given precedence over the other secured creditor. In fact, over pretty much all other creditors, barring a workman's dues and barring the IRP costs. How a secured creditor can realize his security interest is he needs to write out and inform the liquidator of such security interest and identify the asset before such security interest is to be realized. Once he's done that, he's free to go ahead and realize his security interest, which is basically sell the asset that's already secured by him. However, the duty placed upon him is that he has to ensure that the highest value of such security is realized. And he can't do it at any value that he chooses fit, merely because the security is in his name. He also has to ensure, and the IRP, the liquidator has to ensure that in the event that the dues realized from such sale of security interest is over and above that of the secured creditor's exposure, that amount will then go and form a part of the liquidation asset value of the corporate debtor. So that pretty much is the portion insofar as the secured creditor is concerned.
All right.
So
I don't think so, sir. I think you did a very good job of explaining it.
Everyone else has slept off.
Or it could be that.
Could someone just grunt?
No, we've understood. Thank you.
That they're awake.
We are awake. At least I am. I don't know about others.
That's Neha, is it?
No. Nandini.
Thank you, Nandini. Yeah, Shilpa, let's get back.
If you like what Deepak says, you'll have to say Mogambo Khushua.
Shilpa, let's get back.
Sir, we only have to discuss avoidable transactions under IBC now.
So what are avoidable transactions?
Avoidable transactions should be avoided at all costs.
Is there a definition for avoidable transactions?
No, there are kinds of avoidable transactions which are basically preferential transactions or undervalue transactions or extortionate transactions which will be...
So avoidable transactions is a term that Shilpa has just coined. I don't find any reference to avoidable transactions in
it's
the code.
It's not there under the code. It's just...
However, certain transactions which are frowned upon, and in fact the NCLT has been given the power, the liquidator has to identify such transactions, and the NCLT has been given the power to set aside such transactions. Now, the portion of it which may pose a difficulty for many people is that these transactions can be identified to a period of up to 2 years prior to commencement of the resolution proceedings. Resolution or liquidation? Just 1 second. I'm sorry. Just give me a second. The resolution proceedings. So there may be certain transactions which may be identified as a preferential transaction or an undervalued transaction or a fraudulent transaction or an extortionate credit transaction for a period of up to 2 years prior to commencement of the insolvency proceedings. So the problem that this may create is that you may enter into a corporate debtor may or a company may enter into a transaction today thinking that such transactions are not being regulated or not being looked at by anyone apart from maybe the income tax department. But 2 years later, if an insolvency proceeding is initiated and if such insolvency proceedings culminate in liquidation proceedings, then this transaction may be set aside 2 years later. So a company has to be very, very careful in what transactions it carries out today, and I think hope that it does not go into insolvency proceedings subsequently or at a point later in time. So what are preferential transactions? We'll start with a preferential transaction. Preferential transactions has been provided for in section 43 of the code. Simply put, a preferential transaction is any transaction where there is a transfer of property or an interest by the corporate debtor which goes to the benefit of a creditor or a surety or a guarantor and which acts to the detriment of other creditors or sureties or guarantors of the company. The transfer for a preferential transaction is a transfer which has the effect of putting such, I'm just reading it out from the court, the transfer under so-and-so has the effect of putting such a creditor or a surety in a beneficial position. So basically a position which is better than what would have been to other creditors in the event payments were to be made under the distribution waterfall. So basically the order, the priority. So for instance, if 2 years prior to initiation of the CIRP process, you've gotten into a transaction which may give, you know, where you have placed certain monies of the corporate, of the company in the hands of an unsecured creditor before you paid off a secured creditor, that could amount to a preferential transaction. There are, however, certain exceptions and explanations given to what will not amount to a preferential transaction. Any transfer made in the ordinary course of business or financial affairs. So basically, you have to pay off an operational creditor. I mean, this is prior to insolvency commencement of CIRP. You have to make payments to an operational creditor. You also have to make payments to your financial creditors, which are banks. And you choose to make a certain payment to an operational creditor before you service your bank loans, that would not necessarily amount to a preferential transaction, because that's a transaction which is carried out in the ordinary course of business. Because if you do not pay your operational creditor today, there are chances that your operations may come to a standstill altogether, and in that event, you will obviously not be in a position to service your financial debts. So the intention behind this provision is basically to not take within its ambit all transactions that have happened, but for the liquidator to apply his mind, and for the NCLT upon an application by the liquidator to apply its mind to see as to whether the intention of the corporate debtor was such that he intended to defraud or put other creditors of the company in a detrimental position. What amounts to a preferential transaction, to my mind, I haven't really gone through too many judgments on this, but what happens or what, which transactions amount to a preferential transaction is a question which will be looked into by the NCLT from on a fact-to-fact basis. I mean, there can't be any strict standards as such which can be prescribed, but the only guiding factor being as to whether the transaction, the intention of the transaction was such that other creditors of the company would be put into a detrimental position. The procedure also is very clearly set out in the code itself as to when a preferential transaction is identified. Once a preferential transaction is identified, an application will be made by the liquidator seeking intervention by the AA, the adjudicating authority, which is the NCLT in this case. And the NCLT could then set aside the transaction altogether and restore any such property of the company which was transferred by way of such a preferential transaction to a position as if the transaction itself wouldn't have happened. So you can, the liquidator can seek a refund of monies. For instance, if let's say an amount of 10 crores was paid by way of a preferential transaction to a creditor of a company, and the liquidators of the opinion and the NCLT is also of the opinion that such a transaction was indeed a preferential transaction, then an application can be made and the NCLT could actually direct the third party to refund that money back to the corporate debtor for that money to be used for the purposes of liquidation of the corporate debtor. Questions?
Yeah.
None. So moving on, there are also something called undervalued transactions where the corporate debtor could have, so the timeline, so I'm sorry, the period for which the NCLT has the powers to set aside a preferential transaction is 2 years. That is 2 years prior to commencement of CIRP, the NCLT can set aside any preferential transaction if such a preferential transaction has taken place with a related party. The definition of related party is provided in section 5, subsection 24, something which we discussed yesterday. And for other, for preferential transactions with other parties, it is a period of 1 year before commencement of the CIRP. So any transaction, if it amounts to a preferential transaction, 2 years, if it's with a related party, and 1 year, if it's with any other party, the NCLT can set it aside. Moving on.
Okay. Yeah.
There's something called undervalued transactions. Undervalued transactions, in a nutshell, essentially are transactions where the company has transferred some property at a value which is below the market value of that property otherwise. The liquidator can also again identify such transactions. And if such a transaction has been entered into, the liquidator will have to apply to the NCLT seeking appropriate orders. Seeking appropriate orders for a restoration of such property back to the corporate debtor, so that such property can then be used for the liquidation of the company, of the corporate debtor. The period for these, I'm so sorry, there is a relevant period for avoidable transactions, Shilpa, you should have corrected me. There are something called avoidable transactions. Section 46 provides for the relevant period for avoidable transactions, which are essentially undervalued transactions. The period is that this transaction should have been made with any person. So again, the period remains the same as for preferential transactions, which is a period of 1 year prior to commencement of the CIRP with any person, and a period of 2 years prior to the commencement of CIRP with a related party. Moving on, there are also transactions which there could be transactions where the intention of the corporate debtor would be to defraud creditors, where the section 49 of the code, where the corporate debtor has entered into an undervalued transaction just and solely in order to take some asset out of the company to ensure that the creditors of the company cannot reach out to that asset in the event that such asset is sought to be realized by other creditors of the company. Such transactions can also be identified by the liquidator, and an application can be made to the NCLT seeking a restoration of such transaction, seeking a setting aside of such transactions and restoration of the property back with a corporate debtor for the purpose of using such property for the purposes of liquidation. There are also, interestingly, extortionate credit transactions where, And this is very interesting, because there could be certain transactions that the corporate debtor has entered into, financial transactions where credit has been taken or obtained at extortionate rates. So for instance, you get into, the corporate debtor has entered into a transaction with an NBFC where the rate of interest is extortionate. Then the monies that have been paid by the corporate debtor to such NBFC can also be reversed by the adjudicating authority. So that pretty much are the transactions where the NCLT, the liquidator, has the power to identify and apply to the NCLT, and the NCLT has been given the power under the code to set aside such transactions and restore the position as it would have been as if the transactions itself had not occurred.
Yesterday Deepak sir had also mentioned that this is also one of these transactions, or being involved in these transactions, is also one of the conditions to disqualify someone to become a resolution applicant. So in that sense also they become very relevant.
No, how would these transactions disqualify someone? Did we go through that?
I'll just go back to the slide for a moment. I'm sorry, it's not being part of such a transaction, it's being part of a management of a corporate debtor in which such a transaction has taken place.
Are there any questions? Does anyone have any questions?
No. Mugambo abhi bhi khush hai.
Super chhe.
Okay. I have questions pertaining to the waterfall. If I can ask them right now.
Can you identify yourself?
Anya.
Yes, Anya.
Person goes unmute is the person who's asking the question.
Cool.
So I wanted to ask, what about the shareholders or also employees of the corporate debtor? And they draw a salary in a way that it depends on the profit sharing or the amount that's been earned.
Okay.
Where do they stand in the waterfall? Are they treated as employees or and their wages are accounted for first, or they are treated as shareholders, equity or preferential or whatever?
More usually than not, it wouldn't exactly form a part of their salary, but would be incentives over and above their salary. Now, if their incentives over and above their salary, they're likely, and of course, this is, I haven't really gone through a case law on this, but it's likely to be outside the scope of the distribution waterfall, which is basically if there are any others. This would probably fall under the category of 53F, which are any remaining debts and dues.
All right.
Any other questions? Does anyone have a question?
Shilpa, you were discussing the amendment that awards priority to the operational creditors over financial creditors in the waterfall, I think. Can we discuss that again?
It's not in the waterfall, actually. What has happened is while a resolution plan earlier was believed to necessarily also conform with the priority in payments as that has been set out in the waterfall, it was held by the NCLAT that this shouldn't be the case, that there is a the statement of objects and reasons of the IBC indicates that resolution plans should necessarily be differentiated from a liquidation plan. So getting their cue from that, what IBBI has done is that they've amended the liquidation regulations to state that the CIRP regulations to state that the resolution plan must provide for operational creditors' debts to be paid in priority over a financial creditor's debts.
So does that mean all the operational creditors will be paid the entire quantum of their amount due before whatever financial creditors would get?
Not the entire quantum, whatever quantum, the quantum bit remains the same, that it has to be as much, at least as much as they would get on liquidation. But the priority order has been changed. If you see in the liquidation waterfall, their priority is, unsecured creditors come below a secured creditor who's relinquished his security interest.
So then, Shilpa, the same problem continues. You see, the moment you prepare the liquidation value, the operational creditor is way lower as compared to a financial creditor, whether it's an unsecured creditor or a secured creditor. The operational creditor comes after. Now, the problem is that if the quantum is not looked at or not provided for, the quantum cannot be provided for, to my mind. But the problem that remains is that at the end of the day, going by the distribution waterfall, the CIRP regulations provide that it shall not be less than their liquidation value. Now, if the liquidation value ascribable to an operational creditor itself is worked out to be zero.
So the Supreme Court has actually very recently opined that that is okay. If the commercial wisdom of the COC if the COC in their commercial wisdom approve a resolution plan where an operational creditor is getting zero, because that would be the liquidation value of its claim.
So if the operational creditor is getting zero as per the liquidation value of the company, whether that zero is paid before or after does not really make much of a difference. So this amendment is a pointless amendment.
That is true. But I mean, the amendment doesn't make any change in because the amendment has only come in the regulations and the code to that extent, which states that only liquidation value has to be assured to operational creditors, has not changed. So I don't think that the situation has changed all that much.
All right, thank you. Sonia, do you have any other questions?
No, I'm still not clear on this. The idea that you will pay the operational creditor first, but the amount remains the same that is decided in the liquidation amount, liquidation valuation or resolution valuation, it doesn't really give them a preference. It's just the timing, I think, then. The amendment only...
Exactly what I said a couple of minutes back, that this amendment is a pointless amendment. If the value to be given to the operational creditor is zero, it doesn't matter whether that zero is given before or after payment to the financial creditors.
All right.
Questions, anybody? Any doubts? I'm sure you guys have lots.
I think everyone's understood, so.
Sab khush. Should we then end this session?
Yes,
Abhishek. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot for participating and joining in these sessions. We'll be continuing tomorrow with a session on content regulation and issues around it. So look forward to hosting you, and tomorrow we'll be back at our regular time at 11:30. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Deepak. Thank you, Deepak.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.